Our message today is based on the question, why me, Lord? Why me? I'm sure that many of you here today have asked that question at least once in your life. If you've ever gone through sickness or anguish and pain of a sudden or tragic loss, you may know something about what we're going to discuss this morning. Many of us are asking that question today. Why me, Lord? Why me? For the answers to that question, we can look to the book of Job. Some of you may think it's Job, but it's not. It's Job. Good morning. Welcome. John, we haven't seen you in a while. Glad to see you here. You're looking good, buddy. Yes. John Garcia, folks. The Bible tells us that Job lived in the land of Uz. It's a weird place to live. But Uz was not a town. It was an area, kind of. Most scholars believe it was an area that was just east of the Euphrates River. Where Job lived is not important. What the Bible says about Job is very important. Verse 1, book of Job, says he was blameless, a man of complete integrity. He feared God and he stayed away from evil. Remember last week we talked about evil was the absence of God. One of the most extraordinary people found in the Old Testament is Job. Job gives us a great example to follow when we find ourselves in the midst of great adversity. Now, the Lord had a very high opinion of Job. He said Job was blameless and had complete integrity. It's pretty high praise coming from the Holy God. Yes, he had a great reputation. And may I say that acquiring a great reputation such as Job should be one of our top priorities. Not only did he have a great reputation, Job was rich. Look at verse 2 and verse 3. It says he had 7 sons and 3 daughters, 10 kids. 10 kids back then meant you were pretty rich. Jessica, y'all are well on your way to being rich. Besides kids, he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, 500 female donkeys. He also had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in that entire area. Verses 4 and 5 tell us that Job used to pray every morning for his children. Hope you do that too. He used to pray, perhaps my children have sinned and have cursed God in their hearts. You see, Job was a man after God's heart. Now the writer shifts the scene right here from earth to heaven. And when the curtain rises, we see God on the throne before the heavenly court. Verse 6 tells us that Satan came to visit the Lord. Verse 6 says, one day the members of the heavenly court came to present themselves before the Lord, and the accuser, Satan, came with them. Now, I have some questions here. First of all, who are these members of this heavenly court? We're not told. And how does Satan get to be there? Who invited him? I will do some research, and I will get back with you on the answers to those questions. Now, as Christians, we have several names for him. We call him Lucifer, the devil, the evil one, but most people just call him Satan. Who or what is Satan? Through the years, Christians have tended to lean toward extremes on the subject. Either we ignore Satan completely and hope that he isn't who the Bible says he is. Or we focus on giving him credit for everything that goes on in our lives that's not good. Any misfortune, illness, or trouble that may come into our lives. Let's take a look at what the Bible says about Satan. Probably most of you never give the devil a conscious thought. You may acknowledge his existence, but it really isn't that personal. He's some sort of vague possibility, maybe, that's spoken in the Bible, but he's not really real like a real person. But folks, let me tell you something. Satan is as real as I am, and he's the author of destruction and evil. If you remember last week, we just said that evil was the absence of God. Too often, if people even acknowledge the existence of Satan, he's thought to be some kind of comical figure in long red underwear with horns and a pitchfork. Somewhere along the line, Satan came up with a strategy that allowed him to be minimized so that Christians would not take him so serious. Satan is alive and well on planet Earth, and this is his playground. He can be seen in witchcraft, Satanism, occult, and astrology. They're all his works and his tools in an effort to distract people from the truth that can only be found in Jesus Christ. You only have to watch the evening news to realize that we are surrounded by evil, yet we're either oblivious to it or we become immune to it. Christ himself had a few well-chosen words to say about Satan. Jesus called him the enemy in Matthew 13:29, the evil one in Matthew 13:38, the ruler of the world in John 21:31, the father of lies in John 8:44, and a murderer in the same verse. Luke 10:18, Jesus said he saw Satan fall from heaven. And in Matthew 12:26, we're told that Satan has a kingdom. In Matthew 13:38, we are told that Satan was the one who sows evil weeds in with the good wheat. Obviously, this is not the type of person that you would want as a next-door neighbor or to date your daughter. It was Satan who tempted Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. It was Satan who appeared to Christ in the wilderness and tempted him to deny God. And it's Satan who whispers in our ear, "It will be all right. Nobody will know." Never underestimate the power of Satan. Never underestimate the power of Satan. The Bible calls him the prince of this world, the prince of demons, the prince of the power of the air. Charles Spurgeon said, "The best evidence of God's presence is the devil's growl." And if we don't hear the devil's growl, it might be because he just thinks we're harmless. In our own power, we don't stand a chance against the devil. But the great thing is, we don't need to stand in our own power. We stand in the power of Jesus Christ. Back to Job. Verse 7, we see God asks Satan where he's come from, and Satan answers, "I've been patrolling the earth, watching everything that's going on." Verse 8, God speaks to Satan again. He says, "Have you noticed my servant Job? He's the finest man on all the earth. He's blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and he stays away from evil." The Lord questions Satan and asks him, where you been? "Down on earth," he says. Then God asks the question, "Have you noticed my servant Job?" Now, why didn't God just keep quiet? Why did he have to ask that question? Why did he have to point Job out to Satan? Maybe Job wouldn't have suffered so much if he'd have just kept his mouth shut. But of course, that would not give us this story and the encouragement that we need that we get from this story. Verse 9 and 10, we see Satan ask God, "Yes, but Job has good reason to fear God. You've always put a wall of protection around him and his home and his property. You've made him prosper in everything that he does. Look how rich he is." The NIV says that God put a hedge around Job. Now, a hedge in biblical times was a border of thorny bushes around a garden or a vineyard to protect it from outside invaders. In Scripture, the hedge is also used to express a wall of protection from outside destruction or the wrong influence. They didn't have barbed wire in those days. Satan is saying that God protects Job with a hedge so Satan can't harm him. And that's true. When we walk in righteousness, God does protect us and bless us. Satan asks God to remove that hedge. Remove your protection. And he will show God who Job really is. Verse 11 says, "But reach out and take away everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." You know, one of the huge problems is, while you and I know that this conversation is going on in heaven, Job is never told. He can't be told. That's the whole point of spiritual tests. For Job to overhear this conversation between God and the devil would be like a person giving the answers to before the quiz. This was a test. When facing a spiritual test, you have to go on what you know before the test comes. If you lose a spouse, if you lose your job, if you lose a child, if you lose your economic position in life, if you lose everything that once mattered to you, among other things, it will be a spiritual test. How you get through that test will depend on what you knew, what you believed, and what you were convinced of before the test. What do you really, really believe? Ask yourself that question. What do I believe? What do I really believe? For example, one person might say, "God is good." Really? Are you sure? Do you believe that with all your heart and soul? Another might respond, "God loves me." Really? How do you know that? Have you thought through the issues? Someone else might say, "I believe the Bible from cover to cover. The Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it." Really? How do you know? Is it because your Sunday school teacher taught you that? Is it because your parents said it? Or is it because some half-baked preacher told you that? Or is it just a deep conviction in your heart? You say Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Really? Is that something you'd die for? If it's a deeply held conviction, you will, and many others have. But if it's something you haven't thought through, you won't die for it. You might not even live for it. Someone once said, if the truth is not worth dying for, it's not worth living for. Satan is sure that Job will curse God once the bad things start to happen in his life. God says, go ahead, give it your best shot. Verse 12 says, all right, you may test him, the Lord said to Satan. Do whatever you want to him. With everything he possesses, but don't harm him physically. So Satan left the Lord's presence. Big question now comes. Does Satan have to get permission from God before he can attack us? Answer, there's no biblical evidence that suggests Satan needs God's permission before he can attack us. He didn't ask permission before he tempted Jesus. However, consider Satan's argument before God. He said, you've always put a wall of protection around him, his home, and his property. Satan is obviously familiar with Job and who he is. And he's aware of Job's special protection by blessing God. How could he have known this other than he and his demonic minions had already tried their work against Job? What Satan is really asking for is for God to remove Job's protection. Although these verses imply that there are boundaries and rules that Satan must abide by, there's no real biblical proof of him needing God's permission. On the contrary, consider Jesus himself portrays Satan as a murderer, deceiver, and a liar. The very character of Satan proves that he disdains authority, and he's not one who would seek permission nor abide by any permission given. Job was hedged about by the Lord. Satan couldn't get to him without the Lord first removing that protection. Now, God gives Satan limited power, but it's still a lot of power. He says, do whatever you want with everything he possesses, but don't harm him physically. There's no hesitation in Satan's response. So Satan went out from the Lord's presence. Satan got what he wanted. Now it's time to go to work and show God what Job is really made of. Starting in verse 13, we see the devil at work. Now we come to the part of the story that really makes us cringe. Verse 13 says, one day when Job's sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the older brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing nearby, and the Sabaeans attacked and carried them all off. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who escaped to come and tell you. While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, the fire of God fell from the sky and burned up the sheep and the servants, and I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, the Chaldeans formed three raiding parties and swept down on your camels and carried them all off. They put the servants to the sword, and I'm the only one who escaped to come tell you. While he was still speaking, yet another messenger came and said, your sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house when suddenly a mighty wind came and swept in from the desert and struck the four corners of the house. It collapsed on them, and they're all dead. I am the only one who is left to come tell you. Now, I don't know what you would have done, but I know what I would have thought. I would have said, God, what are you doing? God, what's going on? God, what did I do to deserve this? God, are you still in heaven? Jesus, I thought you loved me. I mean, in a matter of minutes, Job lost everything. His oxen, his donkeys, his sheep, his camels, his servants, and last of all, his children and their spouses. You would think Job would be screaming at God, or at least asking some questions, but look at what Job did in verse 20. Job stood up, tore his robe in grief, and he shaved his head, and he fell to the ground to worship. He said, I came naked from my mother's womb, and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. In all of this, Job did not sin by blaming God. He shaved his head, he tore his robe, as was the custom of a person who was mourning. But then he fell to the ground, and he started worshiping and praising God. You see, the main question here is not why people suffer, but why people serve God. I remember hearing the story of Flight 93 on 9/11, the gripping account of everything that happened on the fourth hijacked plane, right up until the time it crashed in Pennsylvania. There's one part where one of the passengers called his wife on the phone, and he tells her, our plane has been hijacked. There are three guys on the plane that say they have a bomb. They've already killed one person. Please call the authorities. And all the time while he's talking, she keeps telling herself, no, this can't be happening. We have a perfect life. We have good jobs. We have great kids. Nothing bad ever happens to us. That's the first reaction that many of us may have when tragedy strikes. Lord, this must be some sort of mistake. These things aren't supposed to happen to me. But the Bible teaches that sometimes they do. John 16:33 says that here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows. Some of you have experienced the loss of a loved one, or the end of a special relationship, or the heartbreaking news that someone you love has cancer. The questions I hear sometimes are, where is God when this stuff happens? What can we do when tragedy strikes? What does it all mean? And where do we go from here? Well, I have answers to all of those questions. But if I can get to the right place, I do have answers to all of those questions. But if you want to hear the answers to those questions, then you'll have to come back next week to hear the answers.